I still remember how the first charge points started appearing in the streets. Now, I don't mean in the 19th century, like in a picture, but modern charge points in the 21st century. They were huge and hugely expensive. They would stand in front of a town hall to show that the municipality was forward-thinking, even if there was no electric vehicle to actually use it yet. Fast forward to now. The Netherlands has 30,000 public and 75,000 private charge points, and I'm considered an academic expert. My name is Auke Hoekstra. I'm a senior advisor of electric mobility at the Eindhoven University of Technology. In these four 10-minute lectures, I'll try to summarize our experience in the Netherlands over the past 10 years. I'll introduce you to the different types of charging infrastructure. I'll explain smart charging, and I'll talk about the role of the different stakeholders. My own research focuses on the use of agent-based modeling, and I'll try some more about that. I'll tell you some more about that, Spark City model specifically. Now, there are many types of charging. In this first video, I will talk about destination charging. And that's basically charging while you are parked at a destination that you wanted to go to anyway. I'll start with residential charging. Your most basic option is to use the special cable that comes with most cars. You just attach it to your regular household outlet at home. And this cable contains a device that makes sure that the car charges at the right speed. So often this is limited to around 10 ampere or something. And in most of the world where you have 230 volts, that means about 2.3 kilowatts. But in the US with 120 volts, that means 1.2 kilowatts. This makes the direct cable relatively slow. At this rate, charging a large Tesla battery could take up to 3 days, just to make the point. A dedicated home charger allows you to use the maximum power that is available from your DSO, your distributed system operator or grid operator. For example, regular households in Europe usually have three-phase power at 16 to 20 amperes and 230 volts, which enables you to charge with around 12 kilowatts, right? Just multiply the two. The US is one phase, 120 volts, but has a wide range of amperages. So it's hard to tell how fast you can charge in the US, for me at least. Charge points often come without charging cable attached. So they can serve cars from different manufacturers. It's really handy. But it's also a bit inconvenient, so in the future I expect standardization, at least per continent. For example, I expect all cars delivered to Europe will have the so-called CCS socket. That means that charge points will have a fixed cable attached to it, which saves space, price, and a point of failure. So, really much better. From our own research, it's clear that almost all current EV users see the ability to charge at home as a requirement for buying an electric vehicle. So really important that we realize this. And since the car is usually connected overnight, there is great potential to shift the moment of charging. You come home at 6 o'clock, but you charge at 12 o'clock. Really handy. And if the charge point can monitor usage independently, also very positive, because you can often get tax advantages from that. In terms of hardware, work chargers are very similar to residential chargers. It's basically the same thing. The biggest difference is probably that most work chargers, at least in the Netherlands, have an RFID reader that makes it possible for guests to use the charge points and be billed for usage. Another difference with home chargers is that since there are often a whole bunch of them that are getting installed at the same time, it's often much more interesting to hire a second party, a third party, a specialist party, to install and monitor a whole bunch. That's why most charge points at work locations in the Netherlands are monitored by a charge point operator or a CPO using OCPP. OCPP, difficult to pronounce, but OCPP. Street charging is probably the hottest topic regarding charging in most countries. The problem is that in cities, most people don't have a private parking space. So they have to park their car in the street, and if they cannot charge an EV in the street, they will not buy an EV. Municipalities like EVs because they reduce noise, they reduce air pollution, so municipalities feel compelled to provide the charging solutions, but they are often not fond of public charge points for several reasons. First, they often cost money, then they require more parking space, and finally, they often don't fit with the city architecture. People find them ugly. Fortunately, help is on the way on all these fronts. Firstly, the price of charging points. It's going down. Exact cost estimates are hard to give. I direct you to the Dutch cost benchmark document for some rough numbers, but it really depends on the circumstances. The important point is that public chargers are almost to break-even point now in the Netherlands at least, without subsidy. So first, the price of charge points has gone down from 10,000 in the early days, the big ones in front of the town halls, to around $1,000 now. Then the whole process of requesting and placing a charge point can be highly optimized. And there's some best practice I would like to mention regarding that. First of all, it's really important that you ask permission of other residents in advance, so that when somebody comes along and says, I have an electric vehicle, I want a charge point, that part of the process has already been taken care of. Preferably, you even designate possible locations for charge point in advance, so you can say to people, if you get a charge point, it will be there or there or there. And then you can basically use those locations based on when how many people buy an electric vehicle. Then you can use a website. Really powerful, simple tool, because it gives one shared dashboard for every stakeholder in the process. That includes the charge point operator, the contractor, municipality, user, and the car dealer. And the grid operator. Make sure that one contractor can do all the physical work. That's also really important. All too often, the grid operator, the municipality, and the charge point operator have different preferred contractors. So there's basically three groups of guys with three separate planners that try to do work that basically one of them could easily do, which leads to extra costs. Finally, the usage per charge point is increasing due to an increasing number of cars. So basically, when more people buy electric vehicles, the usage of the charge points increases and their business case becomes better. We see that pretty clearly in our data. Originally, street chargers had a turnover of about 6 kilowatt hours per day in the Netherlands. But nowadays, although it depends on the location, it's on average about 8 kilowatt hours a day. And it's heading for 10 kilowatt hours a day, or even 12. The best spots can even do 30 kilowatt hours a day. And that's usually pretty profitable. One way to increase usage is to incentivize cars to move with a tariff per minute. So basically what it means is once you're filled up, it becomes expensive to stay in this place and you move on. But, if you do that, people will not like it very much. So you should be very careful with this. Then the usage per charge point is increasing due to the increasing battery size. Many people don't know this, but basically if people have a larger battery, they will not charge every day anymore. They will just charge every third day or something. The graph shows how significant this effect is in a simulation we did in our Spark City model. You can see that you need drastically less chargers if the battery size increases, so take that into account. And since the car charged the same amount, so in the end they drive the same amount, they charge the same amount, but now they charge once every 3 days, this translates into a much larger charge per session. But what about parking places? This is often the biggest problem for municipalities. Specially designed parking, designated parking places that you need, whether for handicapped people, for doctors, or for electric vehicles, are on average used less intensively than non-designated parking places. So that is a problem. No way to deny it. However, once the number of electric vehicles and battery size go up, the disparity decreases. Still, a municipality needs good strategy. In terms of location strategy, a little bit tough topic, but stay with me here. We generally see that it's good to start with charge points close to someone who has indicated he will buy one, because you will know this charge point will be used. But as more people with charge points come along, you should switch to a strategy in which you strategically place those charge points. And in terms of timing, a municipality should start with a few no-regret locations to stimulate public awareness. And then comes the times when it's made easy for early adopters to get one. However, as soon as the trickle becomes a stream, so a lot of people come in, the municipality should start to place charge points on optimal locations before they are requested, right? So, in the end, this proactive strategy, this strategic placement strategy, leads to less charge points, a lot less, that are better used and optimally positioned. It's also better for EV drivers because they are not confronted by waiting time. They simply see, oh, I could buy a charge point here because there's already places to charge them. Then, in terms of how they look in aesthetics, the first improvement we will see that once we all use an app, we don't need the big street signs anymore. This is really something of the past, that you look around and go chasing for a sign. If a municipality wants to be doubly sure, it could use a pop-up marker, like is already used for fire hydrants. You could also make the charge point much smaller and reuse some existing infrastructure so that people basically don't notice a charge point anymore. In the future, it might even be possible to charge wirelessly using a pad under your car, and it could be completely invisible, but don't hold your breath. Standardization between car manufacturers is not there yet, and all cars that are now sold with a plug will want a charger with a plug for another 15 to 20 years. So don't think wireless charging will be able to replace your wired charge points anytime soon. That was it for destination charging. Thank you for your attention.